Hello, welcome back to part two of reinforcement learning. I'm starting a little bit earlier because this really belongs to part one, but I haven't covered it previously. So I want to give you an impression of how these things look like in practice. And this is called an example, so simple example, a wet game of chicken. And I came up with this in 1994. So the agent is a paddler in a canoe. So here's a picture. So this is a river, and the river flows down here. Then here comes a waterfall. And if you drop down with your canoe, the waterfall, you land in the pool, and then you have to walk out to a cascade where it's safe to enter again, and you can paddle again in the river. And the challenge is to be close to the waterfall, because here you're gaining most points, most rewards. But of course, because there's a disturbance, there's a chance that you always will be drawn into the waterfall. So here's the reward. So the state. So this is next to the waterfall. This is far away from the waterfall, and you get most rewards when you're close to the waterfall. So there are three actions. The one is you just let yourself drift, in which case you get closer to the waterfall, or you try to balance the flow, or you try to paddle upstream with force, A equals one. And the equations are really very simple as T. So the state that's sort of ordered, you know, is the old state plus rounded to real number of A, so the action plus epsilon, and epsilon is random Gaussian noise. So with some probability, you get any values here for epsilon, so there's always a probability that you be drawn down the waterfall. And S goes from 1 to 20. What is this? Let me check this again. Anyway. So we're looking at the optimal policy and compared to random policy. So this is action under a random policy. You're somewhere in the river, you come close to the river and drop down, and then you start all over again. So you're all over the place, and if you apply the optimal policy up here, you spend much more time closer to the waterfall, but you cannot completely prevent you from dropping down the waterfall, and then you start on the distance again. So you obviously collect more rewards with the optimal policy. This is the value function of the optimal policy. So this is a state, this is the value function, and it gives you quite high rewards. And it seems to also indicate that it's optimal to stay in this range, around 5 steps away from the waterfall. And this is a random policy where I just randomly choose between the three actions. The values are much lower. But also you would get high reward if you happen to be in state 5. This is the optimal policy. So if you're far away from the waterfall, you should just drift closer to the waterfall. If you're close to the waterfall, you should paddle to get away from it. And that's also one location where you just stay where you are. And so it's very interesting to look at how these value functions really look like. So this is always doing the optimal policy. Whoops. And yeah, we can also look at the Q function. So let's look at the optimal Q function. Remember, this is doing an action and then doing the optimal policy. So if you're far away, the optimal action is the red one, which means drifting. If you're closer to the waterfall, it changes to the paddling situation. And here there's a small place where the balancing is optimal. So this is how a Q function looks like in practice. If you learn it, it can take quite a while to get this, but if you can use with the known model, the policy iteration, value iteration conventions can be quite fast. And of course, here you can also could even just invert these equations for the value function, but for getting the optimal one, of course, you'd have to do policy iteration or value iteration or something of that sort. So this gives you a visual impression how these functions look like. Of course, in most cases, we are not interested in one input dimension, but in many. But it gives you maybe an impression how these functions can look like in practice. And as a summary, so we have two problems. One is the evaluation. Silver sometimes calls it also a prediction. So the evaluation of a policy, so given policy, and you can use the value function or the Q function for that, as we have shown. And to optimize the policy, you can use a policy iteration, which means you have an evaluation step and and then an optimization step. And in value iteration, you do both concurrently. You're optimizing and estimating, and value iteration typically is faster than policy iteration. So far we covered in Silver the lectures 1 to 3. Up to three, 1 to 3, and the discussed approaches are called model-based because we assume that the model is known. So the model is the P of S prime given S and A, and the probability of reward given S prime A. So for this one, we would really only need the expected value, the target function. Or reward function, sorry, reward function. Okay, but we assume that these are known, and these classical algorithms were derived in the field of optimal control and dynamic programming, as Silver calls it, planning. So this was probably in the 50s, 60s, and then more modern work. It might be unusual to consider an infinite future, but even a finite board game is in a way is infinite, just that there are some states which you cannot leave, for example, if the game is ended. But formally, you can think of this as an infinite dimensional, infinite horizon situation. So for all these algorithms to work, the value function or the Q function must be well estimated for all relevant states. So the algorithms have to have converged. And there are different strategies for that. It's covered in the slides, and for lack of time, I don't explain in detail. No, because these are iteration equations, evolving states, and you can go through all states to one update, or you can sort of follow the states. So it's called synchronous updates. Or asynchronous updates. There's something called prioritized sweeping, which quicker updates states with large error. Other approaches are called real-time dynamic programming with full width backup. The iterations are related to the Jacobi method and the Gauss-Seidel algorithms for solving systems of linear equation, which is discussed in a little bit more detail in the appendix. In approximate dynamic programming, the value function is approximated by a function approximator. More about function approximation later. And the iterative algorithms so far we have discussed use bootstrapping because we estimate V and then improve V on V, or estimate Q and improve Q on the current estimate of Q. So this is sometimes called bootstrapping. And now we are discussing model-free approaches where we don't have information, or at least not explicit information, about these two probabilities, probability distributions, and we simulate. But we are either can simulate the real system, or we have a simulation at hand which can generate data. And interestingly, even if you have a simulation, it doesn't mean that you have the conditional probabilities in a convenient form, because, for example, you can model nonlinearities, which would lead to pretty difficult conditional probability distributions. So simulation is definitely a good option, and sometimes is more efficient than working with these high-dimensional probability tables. So part two is really about reinforcement learning, as the first one was more dynamic programming or planning. So model-free prediction or evaluation is covered in Silva lecture 4. In many important applications, a probabilistic model is not available, but we can generate data from the real system or the real world or the environment, or a simulation of the real world. This is the model-free case. No? Before we had the model case, and now we have the model-free case. Model-based case, model-free case. Also, some of these matrices are quite big, and evaluating them is costly. And we consider two approaches. One is called Monte Carlo, which essentially is a simulation of the system, and the other one is called temporal difference learning, TD. And I mean, this is a collection of terms. Maybe you look them up again if later you are unclear about them. So sometimes, it's important to distinguish between the target policy, which is the policy you are actually trying to improve, and the policy which is used in the simulation, which might be different from the target policy. So this is in Sutton Bartow, page 103, for example, define. And there are two different situations. One is called on policy, when both are the same. So you're improving your policy, and at the same time you're changing the way you generate the data. So their target policy is the same as a behavior policy, and off policy, they are not the same. So Q learning is an off policy method, and also important sampling allows other approaches to be trained off policy in an off policy way, also discussed in the appendix. So on policy, off policy, offline, online. Offline means typically you collect once the data, or very rarely, and then you can work with the data offline. You don't have to collect the data. So Q learning in principle can be used offline. In practice, it doesn't work that well. Online means you have to collect new data from the policy during training, from a new policy during training. Then there's learning from episodes. So for some algorithms, you sort of have to wait until the game is over to do some learning, for example, in Monte Carlo approaches, or you need a lot of sequential data about actual sequences of events. So these are called episodic situations. So Monte Carlo policy estimation is quite simple. So you have a fixed policy pi, and you just simulate the system by generating samples from the conditional probabilities, or having a simulator. So having a simulator or from the real world. And then you are calculating this g function. So let's say at time t, small t, you observed the system in the simulation was in state s. Then you're collecting all the future rewards you're observing, and multiplying them by gamma until t is the end of the episode. So it's a sort of the future rewards you're getting. Then you have an counter s of s, which is then updated. So this value is added to the current s of s. So this is a little bit bad notation, but Silva uses it in this way, and the counter goes up. So each time the system happens to be in state S, you calculate this the future rewards, and you add it to this s function, and you also increase the counter of how often you have observed the state s, and eventually you just divide it to numbers and you get an estimate of the value function of s. So you just experimentally observe the returns after you went through state s, and that's a very, and there's a lot of different variations on this, but this is a very simple, hopefully understandable, very simple approach. Simulate the system, observe the rewards, add them correspondingly, and then divide by the number of times you went through state s. Yeah, one important thing is RT plus 1 is now the actual observed reward. So this is not an expected value, because we don't know how to calculate expected values, because we don't have a model. So this is actually now observed at the next timestamp. No? Remember, we always attribute the reward at the next timestamp to the state before. So this can be 1 minus 1, so a real number. Yeah, MC Monte Carlo needs episodic data, so in a game you have to wait until the game ends. MC methods are very robust, but they have a high variance, so it can take a while until you get good estimates, because they don't exploit this bootstrapping effect. They're also quite robust. They also work even when the Markov properties are violated. So the Markov properties means that in our models, we always draw it like this: s only depends on the previous time instance of s, and not on ones which are earlier. Or the stuff which happened earlier must be integrated into state information s. But sometimes you don't know all the states, and you cannot do that. Monte Carlo is would even work in that case, where some of the temporal difference methods would have a problem. So the simulation must be on policy, so you have to simulate based on the policy you're interested in, but can be offline. So you do it once, and then you calculate this with fixed huge simulation. Data must be episodic. For example, in the game, you have to wait until the game is over and see if you won or lose. Then there's temporal difference. So that's the other one. No? It was invented by Sutton in 1988, temporal difference learning. We always come back to the first part. So hopefully you have a good understanding of the first part of the lecture. If you remember, we encountered this policy evaluation update, vk plus 1 of s is r pi of s plus gamma sum over s, transition probability times the next value at s prime at iteration k. Yeah, if you look at this right equation, then we can write it as this expected value. So we have to type r times the probability of r prime. So it must be an r prime, sorry. S prime r prime given as. And here's the policy of a given s. So because this is an expected value, we have to multiply it by r prime. And this is just a sample, this expression over here. And now we can do our sampling trick. So we have to sample this from the right term from this distribution, which just means simulating the system. Excuse me. And then maybe we observe a particular reward, r t plus 1 plus gamma v under the policy pi of st plus 1. So this expression is an unbiased or one sample of this distribution. And so that's easy, because you just say, look at the stuff on the right side and take a sample from that. And the TD0 update becomes tries to pull the value function in this direction of the new target. So it's slightly different from gradient systemed, but let's say this is the new target, this was the old value. So you want to move a little bit in the direction of the new target from the position of the old target. So you're taking the old value and you're moving a little bit in the direction of the new target because everything is simulated and noisy and eta is a learning rate. And this type of equation we will encounter a lot. They all look a little bit different, slightly different, but they have the same character. And it's important to understand where this is coming from. We started with this equation. We looked at the right part here, which can be written as the expected value over the probability distributions of R because of this guy here, and gamma VK of S prime because of this guy. We do one sample, which is the actual observed R and the actual observed V of S T plus 1. And we are trying to move a little bit in this direction, which is the old value plus some distance from the difference between the new value minus the old value. So this is called TD target, and this thing here on the right side is called TD error. And eta is a learning rate. So this is the famous TD0 algorithm, and the other algorithms have a similar flavor. So it's important to get used to this. So TD uses bootstrapping, V from V, that's bootstrapping. It's considered to have lower variance than Monte Carlo. But sometimes it has bias, so it's maybe slightly wrong. It has backups because backup means how far in the future you explore. In TD, it's just one step, and Monte Carlo, it goes all the way to the end of the game, T. Yeah, and there I just want to mention it, but I don't want to discuss it. There's also something called TD lambda with lambda between 0 and 1. And what we discussed is TD 0. TD 1 would be similar, but not quite equivalent to Monte Carlo. And TD lambda includes the so-called eligibility traces. But I don't want to cover it in this lecture. It's confusing and maybe you want to look at this at a later point. So the simulation must be on policy, so you need to do the TD on data which was generated from this policy, but it can be offline, which was a huge fixed simulation. And in training you can sample random subsets, so it doesn't have to be episodic, it doesn't have to be following the order of updates. We can just randomly sample and update the and using this equation. Of course, you have to have ST and ST plus 1 always. And that's it. And the reward. And there's a similar equation for the Q function. So this was TD0 was for the value function, and this is for the Q function. I call it a Q policy evaluation. It's called SARSA. So here it's SARSA policy evaluation. And you're using the same equation from the QPE, which we discussed before. We derived some equation for the infinite horizon QPE. You do the same thing. You look at what you're sampling from. You're doing a sample, and you put this as a target. And move the Q function in this direction. So it's the old term plus some vector in the direction of the new target. This must be done on policy, but can be offline as before. And we can also work with random subsets, SS prime, AA prime, all the stuff which is needed in this updated equation. So we have TD and SARSA and Monte Carlo, yeah, three things. So this was a policy estimation or silver calls at prediction. Now we are coming to control. How do you get better? So far we said how good are you doing, how well are you doing now, how can you do better, and this is covered in silver lecture 5. So first we are looking at value iteration, policy iteration based on the value function, and there we have a problem because the maximization is outside of this big bracket, if you go back to the lecture. And the MC is not a good estimator of a maximum. So we cannot really apply this with the value function. We have to do Q learning. In Q learning, you don't have this problem, as we will see in a second. So value function is bad, but not completely. There are certain model structures where TD is applicable. And these are situations, for example, you find in games, and the concept is that of an after state, and it's discussed also in the appendix. But for now, we want to focus on queue learning, because that works better. So first, we introduce epsilon greedy exploration. Why do we need epsilon? Because if you're let's say we have a given deterministic policy, then the action space is not sufficiently explored for the updates of the policy. So we need some sort of randomness in the actions. So first we are starting with the Q function obtained in some way. We don't want to discuss now how. Then the epsilon greedy exploration is a policy which is defined in the following way. So with a large probability, you choose the action which is greedy according to the current Q function, or to this Q function. With a small probability, you choose a random action. So this is exploration. You don't do what your policy necessarily tells you to do, or your greedy policy, which is deterministic, you're exploring. And one can show that the policy improves by this. I mean, the policy with this greedy is better than the policy if you're just following the argmax here. If you would do a greedy policy. Okay, I should have to check this. If QSA is the, here's something messed up. The Q function is corresponding to the V of S, so of this one. So epsilon greedy improves, in other words. So if you have one policy where QSA is a Q function and it belongs to some value function, then by doing this and being greedy here and having small enough epsilon, of course, you either improve or you stay the same, but you cannot get worse if epsilon is small enough. But this is sort of a policy update. So we need to sort of find the Q function which belongs to this new policy. And in SASA we do that with on the SASA algorithm, we use that to estimate this with SASA. So we estimate with SASA the Q function, then we improve a policy by using this epsilon greedy exploration, and then we go forth and back, and this is called the SASA algorithm. And simulation must be on policy and online, because we change the policy, so we have to get new data for the new policy. And it must be online, because this the SASA update must be happening with the actual policy. Okay, that's also nice. Okay, but what is really sort of the king is Q learning. If you go back, you might remember this equation here. The Q in the next iteration is the reward of the sum over the following state in the old iteration. So as you notice, this is a little bit confusing because the iterations, of course, go from here to here, but in the temporal, not from k to k plus one, but in the temporal sense, s prime and a prime come after s and a. So that's a little bit confusing, but this is the notation also from Silver, and it's difficult to be really optimally with the notation, but it's a correct notation, it's not wrong. So the right side again is an expected value, but the policy does not appear in this expected value, so there's no P of A given S, whereas in SASA there was, because we're doing the max over A prime, and so there's no the probability of A prime given S does not appear in this equation. And again, we do a one sample update, which is RT plus 1 plus gamma max over A prime of Q over SD plus S plus, oh, T plus 1 probably A prime. So T plus 1, comma A prime. And that's really important that the policy does not appear here, because these things are independent of the policy. No? This is conditioned on the action, and this is also conditioned on the action. And this is the reason why Q learning can be done off policy. We can generate data from any policy and still do Q learning and optimization of policies based on this data set. So that's a fantastic advantage of Q learning. So here's the algorithm. It was developed by Chris Watkins in 1989, so also quite early. Remember, TD was 1988. So Q, the Q is the old Q plus eta. Now we here again we have the target RT plus 1 plus gamma max over the Q function of the successor minus the Q of ST and AT. So now the simulation can be off policy, as we said, because this expected value is true for any policy. And it can be offline with a huge simulation. The reason is that we sample from these conditions, conditional probabilities which are independent of the applied policy. And this can be quite relevant in safety critical applications where one is only able to observe the system under control. So in theory, we could do Q learning with one historic data set, but just in theory. Because in practice, you need to explore the states where the Q thing, Q updates think it's optimal, and if you haven't explored that through sampling, then you're probably not going to work very well. So in practice, you're still using a different target policy, so that's the one you're trying to optimize, and behavior policy, which is the one you're using to simulate the model or to get simulations. So the behavior policy can be epsilon greedy with respect to the current Q function, and you repeat the update of the behavior policy and to Q learning to update the Q function of this new policy. And after convergence, of course, the target policy is then greedy with respect to the Q function of the optimal policy. So I should probably add a star there. That's really the optimal policy. Okay, so this was part two. We covered the simulation part. And we first discussed how policy evaluation can be done based on Monte Carlo simulation and based on TD and based on SASA. And then the policy, how the policy can be improved. And it's a mixture. So there's one approach where you combine policy improvement with a re-estimation of the Q function using, for example, SASA. And then the elegant queue learning, where in principle, you could work with offline off policy data, but in practice you would try to get new data in the course of the optimization in this behavioral policy, which is epsilon greedy. But still, it's a nice separation of optimizing the queue function and generating data with the behavior policy. And maybe you get that due to this particular structure in the queue learning, you don't have to get data to optimize queue learning, which are following actually the policy, which is a nice feature. And queue learning is quite a popular approach and used in a lot of applications. Okay, thank you very much. We now come next to part three, which discussed how neural networks and function approximators can be used in these approaches, and then a few advanced topics. Thank you very much.